فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
Whilst there is lack of sincerity in your heart, you'll find that you as an individual, you're getting blocked from understanding the information. Then the author rahimahullah mentions four foundations in which a person should try to attain knowledge for. These are the four foundations in which a person should learn knowledge for. If somebody asked you, why are you seeking knowledge? These are the four things that you need to mention. The author, he explains it, but there's scholars before him who summarized it in three lines of poetry. They said, فَلْتَقْصِدُوا أَرْبَعًا قَبْلَ ابْتِدَاءً تَعَلَّمْ لِكَيْ تَفُوزَ بِالْهُدَى أَوَّلُهَا الْخُرُوجُ مِنْ ضَلَالِ وَالثَّانِي نَفْعُ خَلْقِ ذِي الْجَلَالِ والثالث الإحياء للعلوم والرابع العمل بالمعلوم. Three lines. What are they? The author mentions them. So the person should try to, these things, sometimes you will lose them if you don't memorize them. But he has his own lines of poetry. He said, وَنِيَّةٌ لِلْعِلْمِ رَفْعُ الْجَهْلِ عَمْ نَفْسِهِ فَغَيْرِهِ مِنَ النَّسَمْ وَبَعْدَهُ التَّحْسِينُ لِلْعُلُومِ مِنْ ضياعها وعمل به زكين. He himself summarized it in four. Things like this, you forget them if you don't memorize it in lines of poetry. So that's why it's always good to memorize a couple of lines of poetry to summarize a whole point. The author here says there are four usul. وإخلاص في العلم يقوم على أربعة أصول. Four foundations it stands on. بها تتحقق نية العلم للمتعلم إذا قصدها. Sincerity will be intact if you come with these four, and you make these four your objectives of seeking knowledge. الأول, the first one is رَفْعُ الْجَهْلِ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ, removing and getting rid of ignorance. I don't want to be ignorant anymore. I'm seeking knowledge because I don't know, no longer want to be an ignorant person. I'm not pleased and I'm not happy with being a person who's content with what? Ignorance. وَلِذَلِكَ the salaf of هَذِي الْأُمَّةِ, they used to say, and we'll see some statements like that inshaAllah ta'ala later, anyone who does not endure the pain of knowledge will endure the pain of ignorance. So if you don't push yourself to the, na'am, seeking knowledge, of course it has, look at you guys coming here in the morning, having to leave your houses, some of you guys haven't had breakfast. Na'am, it requires energy and hard work. You're tired, you have so much other fun things you could have done. It has hardship. But if you didn't come or you didn't seek knowledge, then you're going to endure the pain of ignorance. So regardless of whatever situation you put yourself in, hardship is going to come. Whether it's the hardship of seeking knowledge and attaining knowledge, or it's the hardship and the pain and the suffering of what? Of being ignorant. So the first reason you're seeking knowledge is رَفْعُ الْجَهْلِ عَنْ نَفْسِهِ, to remove and to get rid of ignorance from yourself. How would you do that? How can I remove ignorance from myself? The author mentions two things. He mentions two things. He says the first one is بِتَعْرِيفِ مَا عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْعُبُودِيَّةِ, is to learn the matters of ibadat, ubudiyya, servitude that are upon you. So you learn, what ibadah does Allah have on me? Are you with me, brothers? Ibadat Allah has, He wants and He requires from, what are they? Getting to know them, familiarizing yourself to those ibadat. And the second one is, وَإِيقَافِهَا عَلَى مَقَاصِدِ الْأَمْرِ وَالنَّهِي, and then learning and standing over the objectives of why Allah is commanding me this and why is He prohibiting me from this. The maqasid, maqsad, why? Why does the sharia, is he doing it? Why does he want? Anybody who learns those two has become, he's lifted from himself al-jahl, ignorance. What are the two? The first one is بِتَعْرِيفِ مَا عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْعُبُودِيَاتِ, What are the ibadat which Allah has upon me? I'm a mukallaf, khitab al-shara' is coming to me, Allah is addressing me. What is it that He wants from me? Okay, Allah wants me to pray, Allah wants me to fast, okay. Allah wants this, Allah wants that from me. Well, why does Allah want me to fast for? What's the objective and the ultimate goal of my fasting? لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Okay. Then in maqasid, the objectives behind each and every amr and nahi of the sharia. That's the first. It's the first reason why you're seeking knowledge. The second is رَفْعُ الْجَهْلِ عَنِ الْخَلْقِ. It is to remove ignorance from the creation. I'm learning so I can educate and teach others. So I want to remove ignorance from the community I'm from. بِتَعْلِيمِهِمْ وَإِرْشَادِهِمْ لِمَا فِيهِ صَلَاحُ دُنْيَاهُمْ وَآخِرَتَهُمْ أَمَا وَآخِرَتِهِمْ. What I want to do is I want to educate them. I want to teach them. In what? لِمَا فِيهِ صَلَاحُ دُنْيَاهُمْ. The benefits of this world for them, and also the benefits of their hereafter. I'm doing it for that. The masalih al-dunyawi and masalih al-ukhrawi. You have to understand the sharia came to do what? It came to bring about masalih. It came to bring about benefit. And it came to remove and repel evil from the people. Whether it be in their worldly affairs or their hereafter affairs. The third reason why you're learning knowledge is ihya'ul ilm. You're reviving knowledge. You're giving life to knowledge. What does it mean? The author explains it more. He says, وَحِفْظُهُ مِنَ الضَّيَاعِ. وَحِفْظُهُ مِنَ الضَّيَاعِ. By memorizing it from it becoming lost. I'm protecting knowledge, in other words. And the way I'm protecting it is by memorizing it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told us that He's going to protect the Qur'an. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. We are the ones who sent down the revelation, and we are the ones who are going to protect it. How did Allah protect it? He told us. The way Allah protected is, بَلْ هُوَ آيَاتٌ بَيِّنَاتٌ فِي صُدُورِ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ. Allah protected it by placing it in the hearts of the people. By making a people stand up to memorize the Qur'an. وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. أي وَإِنَّهُ أي القرآن. The dhamir is a'id, it goes back to the Qur'an. وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ. Your heart. So the Qur'an came down on the Prophet's heart. Allah protected it in the Prophet's heart. And the Prophet passed it on from his heart to the hearts of the companions. And the companions passed it over to those who came after, and those who came after, and those who came after. And this is the way that the Qur'an was protected. The Qur'an was taken on by a talaqqi. One would pass it to the other, and pass it to the other, and pass it to the other. Later was it written, compiled together. Even then they were still writing at the time of the Prophet. They were still writing it. But the strongest things that the Arabs had was what? Al-hifz. And memory. And anyone who reads their biography will know that. Look how they memorize the ash'ar and the poetry. Don't go far. If you look at our culture, specifically the Somali community, people will tell you events and years that it happened and times that it happened, and you're asking them, where did you get this from? Did you read a history book? They didn't read it. It's mibab al-talaqi. They'll tell you events, little things that happen, and all of it is talaqi. They'll say, this is when it happened, this is when Fulan came in, this is when he left. The woman who sells the milk, they'll tell you events, specifics. They'll tell you lines of poetry they memorized, and they never went to school. They can't write their own names in. It's talaqi. And that's how they used to be. So, ihya'ul ilmi. If you want to give life to knowledge, you have ikhwati al-kiram, it requires hifz, memorization. And inshallah, the author is going to mention that later, inshallah. Talk about how to memorize and matters pertaining to that. Al-rabi'u, the fourth objective of seeking knowledge is what? Al-amalu bil-ilmi, implementing the knowledge. You want to implement this knowledge. and everything in which it commands you. فَلْتَقْصِدُ أَرْبَعًا قَبْلَ ابْتِدَاءٍ تَعَلَّمْ لِكَيْ تَفُوزَ بِالْهُدَىٰ. What does he say? فَلْتَقْصِدُ. The line of poetry, what does it say? فَلْتَقْصِدُ أَرْبَعًا قَبْلَ ابْتِدَاءٍ. Intend four before you seek knowledge. Have this in your heart. Have this intention before you try to attain knowledge. This is the line of poetry that I was telling you all four are in. تَعَلَّمْ. Study and educate yourself. لِكَيْ تَفُوزَ بِالْهُدَىٰ. So you can gain and attain guidance. So these four things is why you want to attain knowledge, so you can gain success. أَوَلُهَا الْخُرُوجُ مِنَ الضَّلَالِ. The first one is to leave and get away from ignorance, misguidance. You want to take yourself away from ignorance and misguidance. وَالثَّانِي. The second one is وَنَفْعُ خَلْقِ ذِي الْجَلَالِ. And the second one is you want to benefit the people of Allah, those who watch Allah created. وَالثَّالِثُ إِحْيَاءِ لِلْعُلُومِ. And the second one is giving life to knowledge. إِحْيَاءُ الْعُلُومِ. وَالرَّابِعُ الْعَمَلِ بِالْمَعْلُومِ. And the fourth one is to implement that knowledge. That's what the line of poetry says. And look at the authors, the way he placed it, it was taken from there. Then the author then says, فَالْعِلْمُ شَجَرَةٌ. Knowledge is the tree. وَالْعَمَلُ ثَمَرَةٌ. And the actions are the fruits that come from the tree. وَإِنَّمَا يُرَادُ الْعِلْمُ لِلْعَمَلِ. So the tree is the asal. What comes out of it is the fruits. The tree itself is knowledge. And the fruits that are coming out of it are what? Are actions. That's what he says.
قال وفقه الله تعالى ولقد كان السلف رحمهم الله تعالى يخافون فوات الإخلاص في طلبهم العلم فيتورعون عن ادعائه لا أنهم لم يحققوه في قلوبهم.
The author now goes into رحمه الله that the salaf الصالح, pious predecessors, and this is something we should make it from our norms and nurture ourselves on, and that is connecting ourselves to the salaf. We will expand on that later inshallah ta'ala in the other ma'aqid inshallah. وَلَقَدْ كَانَ السَّلَفُ. The pious predecessors, رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهُ. May Allah bestow His ending, never-ending mercy on them. The word رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهُ is خَبَرِيَّةٌ لَفْضًا إِنْشَائِيَّةُ الْمَعْنَى. Are you with me? This is powerful. When you hear the word sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when a person sneezes, you say, يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ. They are all a, يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ is not a dua. يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ is not a dua, is it? يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ means Allah is having mercy on you. And it's a khabar, you're telling that. Allah is having a mercy on you. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means what? Allah is sending salutation on the messenger. But the scholars, they say, this is called khabariyatul lafdan. The wording is khabariya in the structure. Sah? But the intent behind it and the objective behind it is what? Dua, supplication. As Allah said in the Quran, وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّصْنَا. This is khabar. The women who are divorced, يَتَرَبَّصْنَا, they're going to remain and wait. No, Allah is saying wait. It's not just saying it. Ah. I mean, Allah is not saying the women who are divorced, they wait 3 months. Allah is saying no, the women who are divorced, يَتَرَبَّصْنَا, they await 3 قر. Whichever call you take. Are you with me, brothers? So this is called, and we're going to study that in al-waraqat. That sometimes it can be a statement, but what's intended from it is what? A supplication or a command. Insha is ma la yahtamilu al-kadhiba was-sidqa lidati. That's what they say. Sah? It's whatever you can't say to a person, you're lying. If I say stand up, can you say to me you're lying? Say that? No. If I say, may Allah give you children, can you say you're lying? It's whatever you can't say lying to. Khabar is what you can say to a person, you're lying. If I say, I drove here, you're telling the truth. You did. Sah? And also that itself, we're going to do ta'liq on it in Kitab al-Waraqat. So the word insha means ma yahtamilu. Insha is ma la yahtamilu as-sidqa wal-kadiba li-dhatihi. This is a general definition. When we come to al-waraqat, which we'll take, I think, not tomorrow, but the day after, we'll expand on it. It comes there for us, inshallah ta'ala, and the different types there is. وَلَقَدْ كَانَ السَّلَفُ رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهُ يَخَافُونَ فَوَاتَ الْإِخْلَاصِ فِي طَلَبِهِمْ. The salafu, rahimahum Allah, they used to be scared of sincerity leaving them. فِي طَلَبِهِمُ الْعِلْمَ, their seeking of knowledge and their attaining of knowledge. Salaf, they used to be scared. What were they scared of? They were scared of sincerity leaving them in attaining knowledge. فَيَتَوَرَّعُونَ عَنِ الدِّعَائِهِ. So they used to have wara. Wara is to leave off anything that's doubtful to you. Originally, that's what it means. When the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith of Umar ibn Bashir, what did he say? Al-halalu bayyinun wal-haram. Al-halalu bayyinun wal-haramu وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورُ مُشْتَبِيَةٍ. The person has wara, he leaves off what? Hassan al-Basri summarized the definition. He said, تَرَكُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الْحَلَالِ مَخَافَةَ الْحَرَامِ. They left so much things that were halal because they were scared of it, the haram. صاحب الورع is a person who leaves off what? He leaves off doubtful issues. Doesn't go that way. He's always on the safe side. He tries to be on the safe side. So the Salaf of Hadhi al-Ummah, they always wanted to be on the safe side when it came to the issue of claiming sincerity. Even though they had ikhlas, and even though they were sincere individuals, ma'adhalika, they would never claim sincerity. فَيَتَوَرَّعُونَ عَنِ الدِّعَائِهِ. They used to have wara from claiming sincerity. The author says, لَا أَنَّهُمْ لَمْ يُحَقِّقُوهُ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. No, it wasn't because they didn't come with sincerity. They did. They were sincere. And they had sincerity. They did not claim it, not because they didn't have it, but they chose not to say, مِنْ بَابِ الْوَرَعِ. From the angle of, because remember, claiming sincerity can go against the sincerity. They wanted to be ones who are far from that. And then now he's going to give you examples. نعم.
قال وفقه الله تعالى فهشام الدستوائي يقول والله ما استطيع أن أقول إني ذهبت يوما أطلب الحديث أريد به وجه الله عز وجل وسئل الإمام أحمد هل طلبت العلم لله فقال لله عزيز ولكنه شيء حبب إلي فطلبته وَمَنْ ضَيَّعَ الْإِخْلَاصَ فَاتَهُ عِلْمٌ كَثِيرٌ وَخَيْرٌ وَفِيرٌ.
The author here, he brings examples now of how the Salaf were. And remember he said that in the Muqaddimah, that the book is going to be ayat which were muhkama and prophetic sunnah and also athar from Salaf wa hadhi al-Ummah, the pious predecessors, statements from them. فَهِشَامْ الدَّسْتَوَائِي. The word, the dhabd of his name, the way to say his name is two. There's two ways of saying his name. You can place a fatha on his name, or you can place a dhamma on it. The fatha meaning on the ta. So you can say dastawa'i, or you can say dastuwa'i. Both ways are said. So you can say dastawa'i, or you can say dastuwa'iyu. His name is Abu Bakr, or his kunya is Abu Bakr Hisham ibn Abi Bakr. Abu Bakr Hisham ibn Abi Bakr. Sanbar al-Dastawa'iyu. أما الدستوائي الربعي. He died the year 154 Hijriya. He said, Wallahi by Allah, Ma astati'u, I am not able, and aqula, to say, Inni dhahabtu, that I went. Yawman a day, atlubu al-haditha, I can't say, Wallahi, swearing by Allah, Wallahi, I swear by Allah, Ma astati'u, I don't have the ability, and aqula, to say, Inni dhahabtu yawman, that I went one day, أَطْلُبُ الْحَدِيثَ, trying to attain hadith. أُرِيدُ بِهِ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, in which I am trying to attain the face of who? The face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I am not able to say that, he's saying. Now if you look at this, he says, فَهِشَامُ الدَّسْتَوَائِيُّ أَمَا الدَّسْتُوَائِيُّ يَقُولُ. صح, he's using the word يَقُولُ, right? And يَقُولُ shows what? يَقُولُ shows a فعل. فعل مضارع, right? It's a present verb. Is Hisham saying this now? The author, rahimahullah, the reason why he brought it is a فعل مضارع, when in reality is a فعل ماضي. This in نحو, or according to the نحات, is called حكاية حالي الماضية. It's called حكاية حال الماضية, is when you're talking about a past tense. You can use it as يقولوا. Then the author, rahimahullah, he says, وسئل الإمام أحمد, and Imam Ahmad was asked, هل طلبت العلم لله? Somebody came up to Imam Ahmad and they asked him, have you sought knowledge for Allah's sake? فَقَالَ, he responded, لِلَّهِ, for Allah's sake, عَزِيزٌ, it's rare. He didn't deny it, nor did he affirm it. Are you with me? This is the wara' that he's talking about. They said, have you ever sought knowledge for the sake of Allah? And he responded by saying, لِلَّهِ, for Allah, عَزِيزٌ, this is rare, it's hard. وَلَكِنَّهُ شَيْءٌ حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ فَطَلَبْتُهُ. But وَلَكِنَّهُ, this dhamir is referring to what? أي العلم, knowledge. Knowledge was something in which I, Allah, placed in my heart love for it. And later we're going to see, inshallah ta'ala, in the second chapter, sorry, the third chapter, that Imam Ahmed, as you all know, his father wasn't the one who pushed him to seeking knowledge. Nor did his mother do. His mom helped him. She wasn't the one who pushed him to it. Who pushed it to him? Who pushed him to seeking knowledge? He himself. He loved knowledge. وَلَكِنَّهُ شَيْءٌ حُبِّبَ إِلَيَّ فَطَلَبْتُهُ. Knowledge was something Allah has made me love, and I sought it. I sought it out of love for it. But he doesn't deny the fact that he didn't say, I didn't seek it with sincerity. He did, rahimahullah. La shakka, he did. Then the author goes on to saying, Shaykh Salih ibn Abdullah ibn Hamad al-Usaymi, وَمَنْ ضَيَّعَ الْإِخْلَاصَ فَاتَوْ عِلْمٌ كَثِيرٌ وَخَيْرٌ وَفِيرٌ. Anybody who forsakes the sincerity, a lot of ilm, he will lose out from it. And a lot of khayr, he's going to lose. If you forsake sincerity, then you as an individual are going to miss out a lot of knowledge, and a lot of khayr is what you're going to miss out. No.
قال وفقه الله تعالى وينبغي لقاصد السلامة أن يتفقد هذا الأصل وهو الإخلاص في أموره كلها دقيقها وجليلها سرها وعلنها ويحمل على هذا التفقد شدة معالجة النية. قال سفيان الثوري ما عالجت شيئا أشد علي من نيتي لأنها تتقلب علي. بل قال سفيان الهاشمي ربما أحدث بحديث واحد ولي نية فإذا أتيت على بعضه تغيرت نيتي فإذا الحديث الواحد يحتاج إلى نيات.
The author then says وينبغي, is required, لقاصد السلامة, the one who is intending safety, the one who wants to gain safety, أن يتفقد هذا الأصل. That you look for this foundation, this issue of its sincerity. This foundation, وهو الإخلاص. The author, he brings a جملة معترضة. Which is what? Which is its sincerity. في أموره كلها, in all of his affairs. Again, there's a تعقيب that should be placed on Sheikh Saleh ibn Abdullah al-Hamad al-Usaymi's statement here. Which is in all of his affairs. Even in sincerity itself, do you have to bring sincerity for sincerity? Huh? So there's dawran. It's infinite regress. You're always going to go in circles. Never going to stop. Is it going to stop? If every sincerity, you have to bring a sincerity for it. And it's something that fuqaha and the ulama speak about. It's the only thing you don't have to bring sincerity for. You don't have to bring sincerity for your intentions. You don't have to. So when the author says, في أموره كلها is عام مخصوص, as they say. عام مخصوص. It's general, except that which is specification, like قوله تعالى فلما رأوه عارضا مستقبل أوديتهم قالوا هذا عارض ممطرنا بل هو ما استعجلتم به ريح فيها عذاب أليم تدمر كل شيء بأمر ربها فأصبحوا لا يرى إلا مساكنهم. The word كل is being used here, but it's not intended by everything. Allah's throne doesn't get destroyed. The destruction that came to the people of Ad, it didn't destroy Allah's throne. Did it destroy Allah's throne? But Allah says كل شيء. Some say that بأمر ربها is the تخصيص that brought it out, and others say that the word كل, even if it's used, it can also mean sometimes عام مخصوص. على كل حال, the author's statement here, في أمور كلها, is not meant by intention. Intention doesn't need an intention, or else you will be going in circles. You'll never ever finish. Every intention will need another intention, and then another intention, and another intention, and another intention. صح? And that's what happens with waswas all day. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, صح? The person can't pray, because he's just doing intention all day. دقيقها وجليلها سرها وعلانها. In all matters, whether that matter is very detailed, or whether that matter is very great, whether that is a secret or private, or sincerity is needed. Privately, sincerity is needed. Publicly, sincerity is needed. Whether that matter is very little, something very small, sincerity is needed. Whether it's something big, sincerity is needed. It doesn't matter. ويحمل على هذا التفقد شدة معالجة النية ويحمل and he carries على هذا التفقد in this looking for and this search شدة معالجة النية to severely cure your intentions. And then he brought the statement of سفيان ابن سعيد ابن مسروق الثوري. قال سفيان الثوري, سفيان الثوري's name is سفيان ابن سعيد ابن مسروق الثوري. He died 161 هجرية. He died 161 هجرية. He said, ما عالجت شيئا, I never cured شيئا علي من نيتي لأنها تتقلب علي. I have never cured or worked on more harder for me than my intentions. لِأَنَّا تَتَقَلَّبُ عَلَيَّ, because it turns on me sometimes. Your intentions work against you. And this is the line of poetry which some of the scholars bring. قَدْ سُمِّيَ الْقَلْبُ قَلْبًا مِنْ تَقَلُّبِهِ فَحْذَرْ عَلَى الْقَلْبِ مِنْ قَلْبٍ وَتَحْوِيلِ. That the heart was called heart in Arabic. The word qalb is the meaning of the word that the heart is used as what? What do you say the heart? What do you call the heart? Qalb. Why is it called qalb? Because the Arabic language qalb means something that turns. The reason why they called it is because لِكَثْرَةِ تَقَلُّبِهِ, because it turns a lot. Are you with me? If a person keeps tossing and turning in bed, what he's doing is what? Qalb. And inshallah ta'ala in Nukhbat al-Fikr, when we look at the narration which is called Maqloob, we'll see inshallah ta'ala. That's why it's called Qalb. That's why the author Sufyan al-Thawri said, "Ma alajtu shay'an alayya ashadda alayya min niyati." There was nothing I had to cure, I had to work on greater to me than my intentions. لِأَنَّا تَتَقَلَّبُ عَلَيَّ, because it turns and tosses on me. And then he brought the statement of who? Sulaiman al-Hashimiyu, who his name is Sulaiman ibn Dawood al-Hashimiyu. Sulaiman ibn Dawood al-Hashimi heard from AbdulRahman ibn Abi Zinad. AbdulRahman ibn Abi Zinad and Imam Ahmad and Ibrahim al-Harbi, you heard from him. He heard from who? AbdulRahman ibn Abi Zinad and Imam Ahmad and Ibrahim al-Harbi narrated from him. From him who? From Sulaiman al-Hashimi. And Hashimi means that he's from the people of Hashim, Banu Hashim. So his lineage enters directly to Ibn Abbas, Ibn Abdul Muttalib. His ancestors is who? Abdullah ibn Abbas. He said, رُبَّمَا أُحَدِّثُ بِحَدِيثٍ وَاحِدٍ وَلِيَنِيَةٌ. He said, I might tell a narration. One narration. I have an intention. فَإِذَا أَتَيْتُ عَلَىٰ بَعْضِي, whilst I'm in that same narration, when I say part of it, تَغَيَّرَتْ نِيَّتِي, my intention changes within the narration. فَإِذَا الْحَدِيثُ الْوَاحِدُ, so one hadith, يَحْتَاجُ إِلَىٰ نِيَّةٍ, it requires intentions. One narration requires intentions. You're reading a hadith, part, the first part that you're reading from the hadith, there's an intention that's needed. You ask, you're in the middle, your intention changes. You see something or someone. Within the statement, your intention changes. So you need all day, you need to fight with your intention. In one hadith. Imagine if it's 45 minutes, half an hour you're talking for. So the person has to realize, ya ikhwah, the issue of sincerity, how important it is. What is it that Al-Imam Sulaiman al-Hashim is trying to say to us? What he's trying to say to us is that رَدُّ النِّيَّةِ إِلَى الْمَأْمُورِ بِهِ إِذَا عَرَضَ لَهَا مَا يُغَيِّرُهَا أَوْ يُفْسِدُهَا. This is what he's trying to say to you. He's trying to say, perfect your intentions. I'm going to take your intention to what? إِلَى الْمَأْمُورِ بِهِ, to that which it was commanded. So when you feel like this is happening to you, what do? You take your heart to that which it was commanded. When two things happen to it, ما يغيرها, something that wants to change it. This changing here doesn't have to be haram. Are you with me? It doesn't necessarily have to be haram. For example, a person wants to fast today. It's Monday and Thursday. They just want to fast. And whilst they are fasting, they change their intention and say, you know, I'm not going to fast, but I'm just going to not eat just so I'm healthy. Hypothetical. This doesn't corrupt and it's not showing off. But he's come to a qasad which is permissible, an intention that's permissible. He just changed it. Get rid of that. Because it's going to make you lose of something better. أو ما يفسدها, or something that will corrupt it, which is the second one. This is where it comes into the issue of showing off. Doing it for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is it that you have to do? Three things that you have to do. 3 points. The first thing is that bring it back to what it was commanded. Meaning, bring it back to إِلَىٰ وِفْقِ الشَّرَّعِ, bring it back to the legislation. Number two, when something tries to change it, don't allow it. And the third point was what in the definition? Something that wants to corrupt it fully and nullify it from Yuna. Also make sure that you bring it back to the Sharia. Naam.
قال وفقه الله تعالى المعقد الثالث جمع همة النفس عليه فإن شعث النفس إذا جمع على العلم التأم واجتمع وإذا شغل به وبغيره ازداد تفرقا وشتاتا وإنما تجمع الهمة على المطلوب بتفقد ثلاثة أمور. أولها الحرص على ما ينفع، فمتى وفق العبد إلى ما ينفعه حرص عليه. ثانيها الاستعانة بالله في تحصيله. إذا لم يكن عون من الله للفتى فأول ما يجني عليه اجتهاده. ثالثها عدم العجز عن بلوغ البغية منه. وقد جمعت هذه الأمور الثلاثة في الحديث الذي رواه مسلم بن الحجاج قال حدثنا أبو بكر بن أبي شيبة وابن نمير قال حدثنا عبد الله بن إدريس عن ربيعة بن عثمان عن محمد بن يحيى بن حبان عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: احرص على ما ينفعك واستعن بالله ولا تعجز. فمن أراد جمع همته على العلم فليشعل في نفسه شعلة الحرص عليه، لأنه ينفعه، بل كل خير في الدنيا والآخرة إنما هو ثمرة من ثمرات العلم. وليستعن بالله عليه ولا يعجز عن شيء منه، فإنه حينئذ يدرك بغيته ويفوز بما أمله.
The author here, رحمه الله, in the معقل الثالث, the third chapter now, he talks about جمع همة النفس عليه, bringing your intentions together, your aspirations together. This is not sincerity, but it is sometimes, as a student of knowledge, your intentions split. Some people, they want to be students of knowledge and they also want to be businessmen. There's nothing wrong with being a businessman. And there's nothing wrong with being a person who attains and gains money and income. But dividing your intention weakens your seeking of knowledge. So this is what it is, جَمْعُ هِمَّةِ النَّفْسِ عَلِيهِ. What you have to do is الصدق. That's the concept of الصدق. Don't associate any other thing with seeking knowledge. When you're doing it, you do it wholeheartedly. It's only it. If you spread your legs out to two different vehicles that are moving, what's going to happen to you? You're going to split in half, right? That's how it is. The dunya goes to a direction and knowledge heads towards another direction. And so what's going to happen to you, you're really going to be what? A person who doesn't attain any of the two. ولذلك is narrated from Abu Ubaid Qasim al-Sallam that he said, مَا نَظَرْتُ أَحَدًا مُتَفَنِّنٍ. I have never debated a person who knows different sciences إِلَّا غَلَبْتُ, except I overcame him. I beat him. Because he's really got legs in so many different fields, I will always beat him. وَمَا نَظَرَنِي, and he never debated a person who's متخصص in one particular thing. إِلَّا غَلَبَنِي, he overcomes me. So when a person puts his mind to one particular thing, and he puts his hard time and everything in something, that then produces what? But if you open yourself so many different projects while seeking knowledge, you're really not going to attain it as it should be. So this is what he's going to speak about here. He says, so that's why, brothers, you seek knowledge before you get married. You seek knowledge before you get married. Once you get married, it's an issue now. The wife wants to say to you, she wants to say to you, okay, listen, today this is the plan we're going to do. Okay, how did it come into place? Student of knowledge hasn't got your vocab that used to be me changes into we, not the French we, the English we. It's about us now. So she wants to take you somewhere, she wants to do something. Not only are the children, they also want their part now. So you're just split into half between your wife and your children, and then seeking knowledge is. So many people, they have to choose between seeking knowledge and attaining knowledge and their family. And there's always that struggle. And that's why it's important, before you get married, before you get into it, you attain knowledge. And I'm not saying that once you do get married, you won't seek knowledge or you shouldn't seek knowledge. That's not what I'm saying to you. But I'm saying it's harder now. Many things are not the same anymore. For example, you can just have, you know, khubz yabiz, a dry bread, break it up, eat it, go to sleep. You've got £10 or £5 in your pocket or your account. You can go to sleep, there's no issue. You have nothing to worry about. But when you've got kids looking at you, and you've got a wife looking at you, I've got £5 and we're going to eat this bread, it's not enough. It's not going to be accepted from you. Sah? It ain't going to be accepted anymore. So that's why Imam Ahmed married when he was 40. He never married before that. After he reached 40, he got to the what he wanted in knowledge. Not that I'm saying he finished knowledge. He had 40 years of seeking knowledge. Then he got married. Ibn Taymiyyah said, I don't even want to get married. Or Nawawi said, it's mentioned, some scholars mentioned in Sirah, he forgot to get married. Nawawi. Yeah. Shocking, right? To forget marriage. But it's like, every time I turn around, I think of marriage. So the author then says, فَإِن شَعَّتِ النَّفْسِ شَعَّتِ means what? Split. If your intention and your drive splits, فَإِنَّ شَعَّتَ النَّفْسِ, the splitting of the nafs, إِذَا جُمِعَ, if it's brought together, a person's heart is all over the place, he's brought together, he brings all of his intentions, he brings all of his drive, he brings his passion and his everything to one place. What happens? إِلْتَأَمَ وَاجْتَمَعَ. The word إِلْتَأَمَ, it comes from the word which the Arabs say, إِلْتَأَمَ الْجُرْحُ. When you have a wound on your hand, what happens? And then it comes together, what's it called? Clots together. Ah, that's what إِلْتَأَمَ means. Your matters all come together now. وَاجْتَمَعَ, it combines. So the word إِلْتَأَمَ, generally the scholars, they use it as to agree. Some things agree together. And also إِجْتَمَعَ means to combine. وَإِذَا شُغِلَ بِهِ وَبِغَيْرِهِ, if the person busies himself with knowledge and other than knowledge,